that recent hurricane which hit the US also had a kind of side effect to Canada as well, or some parts of Canada like Ontario. And a couple of days ago it was pouring rain, like you wouldn't believe, really lashing down. And the following day, which was on Friday, I went into town in a pretty well gale force wind. It was astonishing. Trees were getting thrown down, and the vehicle was rocking side to side when you parked it. It was quite an amazing experience. But that's what happens, of course, with the side effects, you see, of hurricanes. It's a hurricane covers a huge area when you see the massive whirlwind around them. And today we do live in such a system where those who are even experimenting with supposed geoengineering and chemtrailing, etc., admit they're tampering with all this kind of thing, even pouring more and more chemicals into the big cyclones that they create to see what happens. I think they pretty well know what would happen if it works. And it's the same with all other parts of geoengineering today. It's astonishing to even try and find out what's real and what isn't, isn't it? We are in such a almost a virtual reality, that the kind of virtual reality they kept talking about many years ago, how they could bring the whole world into it and knock down all normalcy, especially normalcy to do with your own logic. Because if you can't trust your logic and your own sensory perception, then what can you trust? Then you're told, well, here's what you trust, and they give you a whole new bunch of ideas you're supposed to just believe in because the scientists at the top tell you so. Quite amazing, really, when you think about it. But I've had quite a time of it. As I say, I think three trees around the house went down, or parts of them did, and that's when I got back. I noticed it the following day because I got back almost, it was dark. And then, of course, I had problems with my vehicle. This old, this is the greatest thing they ever designed, was this particular type of vehicle, because at least twice a year, something major goes wrong with it. And now it's the muffler, not the muffler, but the muffler system. Again, even though I replaced it all 3 years ago, something else is gone, maybe a donut or something. They call it donut seals. Who knows? I haven't got a chance to check it out yet. But is this one thing after another, really, isn't it? I was thinking, too, of an old movie that I'd re-watched recently. Very old one, and it's with Charlton Heston, where he's a kind of plantation owner in Argentina, or it could be Argentina or Brazil, actually, hard to tell. And he's built his beautiful palatial living quarters, etc., and he orders a wife in, basically. Those days you could actually bring them in and pay them and the whole bit and then marry them. That was an old technique too, if you were stuck in the wilderness somewhere. Even in the US in the 1800s, that was what wasn't that infrequent, in fact. But anyway, in the movie, he talks about how everything rots in a high humidity with kind of jungle-type heat and humidity. But we really have that in different parts of Northern America as well. I was thinking about that as I took up the trees that had fallen over and the rot that was in them. And I think, is any coincidence that the big lobbies that create the training for designing and building with the materials of wooden houses, is any coincidence that this is what they've pushed so much here? Because really, it's such a massive business that's constantly repairing homes. And except Canada, for instance, the wooden homes. Because yeah, you get ants in them, you get all kinds of things coming in, you get rot anyway. And they're constantly repairing things, of course. It wouldn't happen if they're made of bricks. So I've often wondered about that. They'll always tell you, well, that's the reason they're built of wood, because it's so plentiful. But by the same token, yeah, I could see it being done in the 1700s and 1800s. But once you get into the 20th century, they didn't really have to do that anymore. They could easily have just used stone or made bricks and made more permanent dwellings. But I gave talks in it years ago that they didn't really want certain areas to be permanent. Is it really that coincidental that they threw up houses very quickly wherever they could get mines on the go and things like that, and really exploit the minerals and resources and so on. Is it any coincidence that they threw overhead wires all over the place rather than bury them as they would do in a city and things like that? And then you realise, no, it's not coincidence. Things weren't meant to last forever. In the 20th century, the big, big mining companies already knew pretty well how long any particular mine would last. So all the houses that would build up around it as they brought in miners wouldn't have to be that permanent anyway. It kind of ties in with the whole idea of the visionary future where they don't want folk on the countryside anymore under Agenda 21 for the whole 21st century as they implement it in stages. And it all ties in together naturally because, in fact, I said it even before it became so popular to talk about Agenda 21 that they would start to see everything was unsustainable, like keeping electricity supplied to your area. That'd be unsustainable, or even transporting gasoline to any nearby garages or pump stations would be unsustainable and not worth it, sort of thing. And you're seeing that already happening. When they bypassed a lot of towns, which used to be on major highways, the old roads were major highways. In Ontario, for instance, is an example. And they followed exactly what they said to do. From conference where they printed up their findings, the United Nations, that they would have super cities and they would literally bypass little towns and so on that really made their living a lot of them off the tourist industry. They'd bypass them, therefore cutting them off from their livelihood, and they would close down roads eventually. And that's exactly what they do. I've had it happen near me where they literally create a new highway. That what I lived on, or next to me, was the old highway, a small road, or narrow road. And then they closed off the road, the old road, which goes through the main part of this little one track town, basically, one street town. They closed the bottom of it off so that you couldn't use that anymore once you get past the end of the town there. All thought out in advance, really, isn't it? And you have no idea that the forward thinking, they call it forward thinking, of the planners and how it all ties in perfectly with global agendas. It really does. And eventually, of course, they'll say, well, it's unsustainable, so you can't really live in the country. We're not putting you off. It does make it impossible for you to stay. That's how they do things. And that is happening, actually, as they go on their... They've already trained their armies of sustainability children, basically. Very sustainable. Everything has to be sustainable. And they'll parrot these things like any radicalized, indoctrinated young group in history, like the Young Communist League or the young Socialist or Nazis League. Same kind of thing, Hitler Youth type of thing. They'll prattle off. Just as if you look up the old propaganda films they made about Mao Zedong's China, for instance. And then you'll see them all quoting out of Mao Zedong's little red book, they called it, and you see them all waving their book like it's a Bible. And it was, to them, it was made to be a Bible. And they could quote that off verbatim with this. Well, when they grew up, they were you couldn't argue with them. And it's the same with any radicalized young group. It's an old technique, grab the children, and you can make them believe anything with the proper scientific techniques. I've said it so many times in my talks, from even over 20 years ago, in fact, and it's all been proven true, not because you're prophesying something, it's because you've read their stuff and you've studied their stuff, and you're lucky enough maybe to retain it. I guess that's part of it too. And to be interested, and a lot of folk aren't interested, because they are contented. They don't even realise that they're contented because they were designed to be contented, at least the system they're now in. And I'm not kidding you by those, as I've said before, who lived from even Bertrand Russell lived into a good part of the 20th century and took part in planning the cultural changes for world government from the 1800s onwards. Lord Bertrand Russell. Interesting family in itself, because they, like many of them who became lords, and helped run the country for themselves, that is, because it really, a corporation's a different thing from what the people are told it is. That it's not their country at all, in a sense. But the Russells, for instance, and many of the other ones involved with the seizing of old Catholic property in Europe and one Britain especially, after the different kind of Protestant sects broke out, as opposed to the Church of England. The Church of England is a protesting system, but it's really Roman Catholic in origin, much more so than any other organization, with the monarchy placed as the Pope, basically, the head, you see. But at the same time, too, they stole lots of the Catholic Church's property. That was an integral part of the commerce even of that time. And the whole system changed into that of usury, in a sense, because many of these noble families that became the lords, like the Russells and so on, they were very envious of those who were allowed to use usury because of the profits that could be made. And so they seized the properties, and then they themselves set themselves up to lend to the governments, which they were part of at that time. And therefore, those in power always make sure that they design the future society to suit themselves. And it's not as difficult as you would think. It's difficult for the average person to think in a long-term planning phase, basically, how we can really get things done when you plan it so far ahead. I could say 150 years, but it's nothing to a foundation, as I say. A foundation is created with a purpose and a set of tenets to achieve, and therefore can hire, retire, and fire, and rehire, et cetera, generations until it's achieved its goal. That's why they have these tax-free foundations as a form of stability for those who rule the world, or rule a good chunk of it, and who want it all, actually. And the old universities they set up too were all part of that structure as well to make it happen. Not difficult at all. When you've got unlimited financing, which you just take from all kinds of sources, including sales. At one time it was sales or import duties was a big one. And that's why all the major cities, including the city of London, had massive incomes from all trade of incoming ships with goods from abroad. But eventually, of course, for a system to get more and more helpers, you might say helpers, a kind of civil service society, who are not serving the public, but they're a service to those who own the countries, they had to get paid huge salaries, much, much higher than they'd have in Civvy Street, basically. And so they're given big salaries and lots of perks of all kinds. And therefore you need more and more money as you're bringing in a system of what's called free trade, where you're going to start losing out on import duties. So you then start taxing the public, so you create income taxes, you see, which was forbidden to an extent through debates through the 1700s, 1800s, because it was seen as a form of slavery. If you take away the earnings of a labourer, he's therefore just a slave. And so they call it temporary war taxes, or in the US was victory tax. And of course it stays on there forever. Because you're not ruled by a system that has you in mind as what do you want. You're never asked what you want. All they want you to do is vote, because it's simply a legality where you put yourself under, and that's the expression that's used, under the authority of whoever is put in front of you to vote for. And the politicians are sold as a package. I've said it before. They're like an advertising package of whatever item it happens to be, the commodity, and they sell you it. You don't know who they really are, these people. It's not intended that you, actually it's definitely not intended that you really know who they are. And they all belong to the same big club, basically. And I've said before, Carroll, Quigley mentioned it, how the leaders, especially of all these groups, and maybe one or two just beneath them, they're all in the same club of the CFR, Royal Institute for International Affairs. And it's much, much more powerful than you think, that whole organisation. Don't ever think it sort of faded away after World War II, because it didn't. It got more and more powerful, because it was the embryo for world governments, It had the structures set up before the US took it over, and the US works completely hand in glove with them, with this strange body that came out of the City of London. And anything that's anything has its headquarters there in London, including the Grand Rites of Freemasonry groups and so on. They all have their headquarters, or a headquarters there, in fact. So you've got a lot of control there. Anybody who's part of this whole structural system, which keeps the system going, regardless of who you think is in power, it never gets lost, you'll notice. You don't get overthrows, you don't have coups happening or rebellions, open rebellions. It doesn't happen, does it? Because the structure of holding the system together all through society is well maintained by those who belong to different orders, etc. But the planning ahead is so trivially well understood how it's done, and the techniques to do it, and the machinery to put it into place is so perfect. Last week I mentioned that really we're like a big gene pool for the elite, in a sense, and they see us like that too. And the more those people from academy that they employ to train us and study us and then implement the techniques through entertainment, television, media, and through the internet, all through the internet and cell phones and so on, it's rather perfect the way that the system they've built up to take care of all of us. And most of the folk never think about it. They don't know about it, or it goes in one ear and out the other. It doesn't stay there. And they continue their lives as they think is normal, but they're being altered all the time. All the time. And the main thing for these people is to be content. And I was thinking that too. I remember an article I read years ago of how they couldn't have another Bolshevik-type communist overthrow, as they had in the Soviet Union, because they didn't have the same poverty circumstances as today as you had then, when people were rock bottom poor. Those people especially, you had to recruit them to fight your battle for you. That's how the elite saw the one to overthrow the Tsar, you see. They didn't have any compassion for the people. Great show of it, but really they had none at all. But the general population had to be used as an army, a battering ram, to overthrow their royalty, you might call it their royalty, so this other bunch can take over and rule it, basically, using supposedly scientific formulas which were more advanced than the old techniques. But they couldn't have one in the UK, and definitely after the World War II, and parts of Europe too, because the people weren't starving as much. They were bad enough in Britain, really bad actually, the working class people. They weren't starving. And then they let them have cheap television sets. I remember doing a show on that back in the 90s, how the US government were subsidizing television sets to be brought in from the US, used ones, and giving you transformers to boost it up to 220 or 240 volts from 110 they were using at the time in the US. And so they reconditioned these televisions to sell them cheap to the public on higher purchase, which is you pay it up, basically. So many shillings a week or a month or whatever. Because the folk were broke. They're absolutely broke. And every child born at that time in Britain, through the 50s and 60s, and probably the 70s, but definitely the 50s and 60s, and mid the 40s, late 40s, right through, with the National Health Service came in, every child born had visits by nurses in their homes, would come to their homes, and they'd get bottles of cod liver oil, literally, and orange juice. And that was the old joke, if someone got pregnant, you'd get the orange juice and cod liver oil shortly. And in Britain, they were still getting, every baby born was still getting a ration card issued and given to the parents, naturally, at birth, and it went on to about 1953 or 4, I think it went on to. And even then, they couldn't afford decent food. A lot of people, it took a long, long time. The children of them, and then the children, that's really the children's children now, they have no idea how it was not that long ago. None at all. They can't imagine it. And people just didn't have extra income. Not that many folk had cars, for instance. And they would just get by, and everything they bought basically was used. The second-hand business for furniture, for everything, was just massive across the whole of the UK, especially the working class areas. But all planned that way, of course. And you really think, the people are taught to think and trust and believe this is your country, this is your nation, these are your people, these are your royalties, these are your yada yada yada. You have no idea of the minds and the brains at the top in academia working for them to manage all of it and to alter you and how you think and to keep you thinking happy. I mean, for instance, when they got these cheap, back then it was expensive for everybody. Any extra cash outside of buying the basics was therefore expensive, but they had these subsidized televisions, refurbished ones, and from the States they were brought in. And they gave them lots of entertainment to keep them occupied, preoccupied, and again to stop them from conversing and complaining about things and doing anything about it by forming committees or getting together. And one time they did. They would form committees, get together, local people. Again, don't forget too, they're kind of family-based, therefore whoever affected one family affected them all, and they'd all stand up together. It was much more, again, well, even H.G. Wells talked about this system, how they would have to destroy the family unit. Bertrand Russell said the same thing. And then the peasant, basically, would be just them standing, the peasant and the government would talk down to them. There's no one standing around the peasant to protect them. Like a family or a community or anything like that. That's how you're thanked for all your service to defend your countries and so on. So natural tendencies are used against the people always. And it's easy to keep reuse the same tendencies with simple propaganda. You're under attack, blah, blah, blah. Join up and fight the foe. And they always tell you who the foe is going to be. Oh, it always works. But anyway, as I say, after that, they couldn't really think that it was that terrible they could have an actual revolution. It was easier to contain it and stop it from happening because they didn't have the starvation level poverty in the Soviet system where they had it really, really bad at that particular time. And again, it's mainly through agitation by the far left. A lot of it got that way. It wasn't just World War One. It was the agitation by their far left who stopped and they would attack any charitable foundations that came in to help in any area where folk were starving or hungry or whatever, or ill even, because it would stop the revolution from eventually happening. And they tried that in Europe too. But anyway, that's a different story altogether. What I'm saying here is you have no idea of the sciences that go into making you you. And who it really is meant to benefit. As you sit and discuss the fact that what you have today in the lower orders of society are just the defunct genes, the junk genes, as I like to call it and joke about it, of the gene pool, those who hadn't made it to the higher orders and the higher levels of things. They're rather open about it today, very open actually. So this might be a part continuation of last week's talk, maybe part two, because it's really two things in one. It's the system I've talked about where you have a British Empire system. Cecil Rhodes was a part of it, Lord Alfred Milner, and this all blossomed into the Royal Institute for International Affairs. It blossomed into CFR across the world as well. It blossomed into other organizations where future leaders are picked and trained as children to rule over the rest. I've always said this. This is how they do it. It's also how they give you front people who are supposedly geniuses, and they're backed incredibly well financially, and they play the part very, very, very well. And they're well rewarded for it too. But across the old British Commonwealth countries, it might surprise a lot of people to realize that pretty well all their leaders are already picked for them by a common source of people or training from the UK. Very old system. They don't just talk about things at the top. They do it. These aren't little debating societies when they have meetings world meetings, something like the ones at Davos, for instance. But you'll find that all of the groups, the IMF, the World Bank, the Bank for International Settlements, the left-wing groups under the Fabian Society, the right-wing groups under any other society, their top members are all members of the same institute today, because the Rhodes Society and the Milner Group blossomed into the Royal Institute for International Affairs. And every country that was part of the British Empire and still is, the Commonwealth they call it today, and some that were never part of the empire and which are now, by the way, as far as the Commonwealth goes, are all part of it. And their leaders are actually trained. And you can imagine that if you see the changes, the cultural changes happening in your own country, how far they've gone. That if you're training children to rule other parts of their world is to be the same, then these youngsters, as they're growing up, will be so politically correct in every area, because they must then, as they're growing up themselves and taking over power, implement all these agendas across the countries that they're in. That's how deep it is. This is not conspiracy theory. This is fact. And you can actually look it up yourself, some of the things I'll mention tonight. Folk have no idea. They have no idea of just how involved all of this is at all. None at all, really. And the rest don't really care, because, as I say, they've been so indoctrinated very well that it really has no import to them. Last week I mentioned, too, that one of the meetings that the Royal Institute for International Affairs had, and had all the different major ones, Royal Institute for International Affairs for Canada, the ones for Australia, for New Zealand, and so on and so on, South Africa, etc. All the top members were at it. And also they had their top members that were all members of it, too, from India as well. South Africa, United Kingdom, Ireland, India, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, etc., etc., etc. They were all there, and many other countries besides, by the way, who have no idea that they're those who rule them were all trained by these groups from Britain. And their education was all paid for as well from Britain by the taxpayer, who's awfully kind to the World Department. They go into world government in the book, of course. That was always the goal, and they talk about quite openly. They have different members. Again, even Bryant was in here too, Lord Bryant here. He was quite a player too after World War II as well, as before it. And even the setting up of the Balfour declarations in here too, they allude to that as well. And some of the people who were there actually, who helped set it all up, are actually present at this big world meeting that the book was written about. And it was four members, this book. And really, they talk about if the Commonwealth system, which Britain, this entity, had created in the first place, because it's an entity, it's not what you think it is. It says, the commission from whom the notions of world order and world government were inseparable. This is the commission that they had set up. The object of human existence was to develop the sense of duty in each man to all others. Duty, see? To accomplish this, the political system must be one that exercised the sense of duty. And that's what they get through what they call the orders that they end up joining, often through the fraternities at universities, if they're picked for them. For the higher ones, they have to be asked into them, actually. You don't just apply to them. Lower orders, you can actually apply. But the higher ones, they approach you like the Council on Foreign Relations. You know, you can't just go and join it. If they want you or need you, they'll approach you after they've vetted you. And you don't even know you've been vetted, of course. That's how the world is really run. There's so much in this book. They even talk about the war with Japan and the US before in the 1930s. Eh? But for everybody else, it's just coincidence. Eh? Where is it here now? Something said by one of the delegations from New Zealand, I think it was. They talk about world governments and... Again, you'll see all through, again, the good life, sense of duty, blah, 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 over and over, British Commonwealth, world government, etc. And it's not world governance, they called it then, and it isn't amongst themselves either, it's world government, of course. Now, if you can imagine, this is the group that set up the World Bank and the Bank for International Settlements, all the rest of it, talking about world government. And since they run all commerce across the planet on the top scale of it all, who do you think it's meant to benefit? Really, you know? Who do you think it's really meant to benefit? In this particular book, from the meeting of the Royal Institute for International Affairs, in the 1930s, late 30s, on page 1 or 229 is on the future of the Commonwealth. It says, in replying on the debate, the opening speaker dealt with the points made by a number of the speakers from all over the world, remember. In particular, he rejected the concept of personal union, since the essence of union under the crown was that it covered a common citizenship. It may be mentioned here in passing that in the course of the debate, a somewhat similar criticism was passed by an Indian member on another suggested basis of Commonwealth unity, such as the concept of a common race, or of Anglo-Saxondom, or of Great Britain as a mother country of all Commonwealth members. The opening speaker said that he had been asked what he meant by world order, and the one from New Zealand, that's what he said. He says, "I mean a world government," he replied. "And I'm absolutely certain it's coming. I mean a real government. I know that it's divine, far off the event. We shall see it, but not now. We should behold it, but not now or nigh. My dream is that there are things that we can do now to lead to it, and that the British Commonwealth may be the means to that end." And that was exactly what it said long before that, in fact, with the Cecil Rhodes group when they set up their foundation for world governments, and the Milner group did the same thing too. This is an ongoing inter-century idea, and it's well-financed, well-planned, and anybody who's anybody in any governmental system, and academia too, they're all members of it. They're all members of it. As I say, when you tie that in, this organization in with, again, another member of it, wasn't just Lord Bertrand Russell, but you've got, and he worked too with Julian Huxley, the founder of UNESCO, United Nations Education and Cultural Organization, Scientific Organization. The science part too was to use science on the general public and to train the children worldwide and the whole planet into a common culture, a common idea, but commonly to be managed by the elite at the top. That's what it was too. Very important, that part. And if you look again at what they set up as well, and I'll put some links up tonight on UNESCO and the British Council, it's called. The British Council has bases across the whole planet and all dozens and dozens of countries. And they bring in the children that they select, and they will further screen them and educate them and pick the ones for future leaders across the planet, and even bring in ones into Britain that they've trained from childhood into all the PC stuff that we hear today. And they govern the people in Britain too. Remember, it's to be an international idea of things, but not a free society as folk think of it, where everyone is free to plan or think for themselves. That's forbidden to think for yourself today. And of course, the internet's being used more and more with all the warnings, etc., to make all that happen. Planned long ago. Remember too that a lot of praise has been given too to Lord Bertrand Russell, who, although he put himself up as a philosopher, his main thing was mathematics. And he talked about a perfect language of mathematics that would rule the world. He's talking about the coming computer systems, for those who don't quite figure it out. And he's given lots of praise by those in academia for that, in fact. When you go into the groups that work together to manage and change society, to make it all happen for this, again, this great ideal of this corporate Britain idea of running the planet, with the US too, naturally, with their Council on Foreign Relations, which is a branch of the same organization, they've been awfully successful. And you think about Bertrand Russell, and I mentioned before the books that he wrote, maybe folk get bored with them in this day and age, probably do actually. Russell, remember too, he had his own experimental school, I think it was the 1920s, where he went further than most schools of that time. Remember, they had rather strict rules, much more strict about society and culture back then. But he had this kind of school, and he experimented on the children on techniques of control and literally there were real experiments upon them. But he said in his book, the 1951 book, I've read parts of it before, The Impact of Science on Society, he says that physiology and psychology afford fields for scientific technique which still await development. The two great men, and he said Pavlov, remember Pavlov did all experiments with animals to shock them and recondition them and literally torture them into changing behavior. And they were using drugs as well, of course. So very important. So you have real physical torture, really, then drugs, then psychology used, all together. And it wasn't just to train dogs, it was to train people. I hope you understand it. You know? So this is a afford field for scientific technique, which still await development. The two great men, Pavlov and Freud, have laid the foundation. And even saying that means that Pavlov and Freud are part of an organization that pre-existed and were probably selected themselves, these characters, for their roles in society. I guarantee you that's how it happened. Anyway, so it still awaits development. The two great men, blah, blah, blah. And he says, but I do not accept the view that they are in any essential conflict, but what structure will be built on their foundation is still in doubt. It's not quite sure. I think the subject which will be of most importance politically is mass psychology. Its importance has been enormously increased by the growth of modern methods of propaganda. Of these, the most influential is what is called education. Religion plays a part, though a diminishing one. The press. Now the press now is TV and internet, really. You can get it all from internet. And he says, and the cinema, movies, and the radio play an increasing part. It may be hoped that in time anybody will be able to persuade anybody of anything if he can catch the patient young and is provided by the state with money and equipment. Well, that's all been well done before I was even, born. And he also said that the subject will make great strides when it's taken up by scientists under a scientific dictatorship, for those who don't quite get it yet. You're ruled by experts, supposedly. The term expert. He even mentions that they train you to believe in experts and to be unsure of yourself. You'd always obey an expert. That's been done. The social psychologists of the future will have a number of classes of school children on whom they will try different methods of producing an unshakable conviction that snow is black. Now, take that topic into anything that you want, right? Huh? Boy, girl, whatever. Unshakable conviction that snow is black is giving you a simple tongue-in-cheek example here. Various results will soon be arrived at. First, that the influence of home is obstructive. Second, because we're rid of the home and parental input into the child's behavior. Second, that not much can be done unless indoctrination begins before the age of 10. Third, that verses set to music and repeatedly intoned are very effective. Fourth, that the opinion that snow is white must be held to show a morbid taste for eccentricity. So just being eccentric, you see. But I anticipate, he says, it's for future scientists to make these maxims precise and discover exactly how much it costs per head. So it's cost-effective to make the children believe the snow is black and how much less it would cost to make them believe it's dark grey. So he's, again, tongue-in-cheek, is saying, that, yeah, they can make them believe anything you want and we'll find the cheapest way to do it. He also said that although the science will be diligently studied, it will be rigidly confined to the governing class. The governing class, for those who don't get it. You don't elect the governing class. And I don't really mean that. He's not talking about politicians. The populace will not be allowed to know how its convictions were generated. When the technique has been perfected, every government that has been in charge of education for a generation will be able to control its subjects securely without the need of armies or policemen. So you understand it. You also talk about the lethal chamber for children who are very clever And it'd be, they'd always test and test and find the clever ones, you see. He said, also said too, that they would use different techniques on everybody to make people docile was awfully important. He says, in like manner, the scientific rules will provide one kind of education for ordinary men and women and another for those who are to become holders of scientific power. Ordinary men and women will be expected to be docile, industrious, punctual, thoughtless, and contented. Contented, remember? Of these qualities, probably that contentment will be considered the most important. In order to produce all the researches of psychoanalysis, behaviorism, and biochemistry will be brought into play, some with drugs as well. All the things that Aldous Huxley had mentioned in the 1930s, eh? With the different grades of humanity they create in Brave New World. All the boys and girls will learn from an early age to be what is called cooperative. That is, to do exactly what everybody is doing, everybody else. And that's what they're doing. It's all PC stuff and so on. And anyone who shows leadership qualities will be crushed, basically. And now they're drugging the boys, especially, are getting drugged at school by prescriptions. You think it's all accidental? Because he talks about this, doesn't he? Using biochemistry and so on. So anyway, you'll be cooperative and you'll see the same things because you don't want to offend anybody else, blah, 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 blah. It's all there. And you'll do what everybody else is doing. Initiative will be discouraged. And these children and insubordination without being punished will be scientifically trained out of them. And that's what they do in school now with groupthink and so on. And you're pushed to the side and kind of shunned. Everybody wants to belong to the peer group. When you're getting shunned, you feel guilty and rotten. And so you just cave in and go along with them and agree with them. And I remember that book was written, I think, in 1951 or published then. It says, except for the one matter of loyalty to the world states, it's talking about the children, the ruling class ones, and to their own order, members of the governing class will be encouraged to be adventurous, full of initiative, and will be recognized that it is their business to improve scientific technique and to keep the manual workers contented by means of continual new amusements. Does that ring bells? Remember, they're using the star machinery, the star techniques of making the star machinery for different people who are now in charge of internet and so on, aren't they? But remember too, when it came to testing children who were brights and who are not of the ruling class, and it says on those rare occasions when a boy or girl who has passed the age at which is usual to determine social status shows such marked ability as to seem the intellectual equal of the rulers, a difficult situation will arise requiring serious consideration. If the youth is content to abandon his previous associates and to throw in his lot wholeheartedly with the rulers, he may, after suitable tests, be promoted. But if he shows any regrettable solidarity with his previous associates, meaning his own class, the rulers will reluctantly conclude that there's nothing to be done with him except to send him to the lethal chamber before his ill-disciplined intelligence has had time to spread revolt. This will be a painful duty to the rulers, but I think they will not shrink from performing it. Because, in other words, if you're really clever and you understand what's going on, you'll be a threat to them. Now, they don't really mean what they say, the big boy. They don't plan and then give you chances to say your bit and all that kind of stuff. Now, they come after you. Yeah. And they also talked about, basically, a pharmacologically manipulated slave, how to create them. And even living in a concentration camp, he said, of the mind. And they would use propaganda and psychotropic drugs to keep you there, basically. To love your servitude, as Huxley's talked about it, of course. So it's all there, really. There's nothing to guess at, especially when you've watched it your whole life long unfold and been implemented with goodness knows how many different organizations, all worked from the pyramidal top, by the way. And there's thousands of these organizations, all run from the pyramid cap. Remember, too, that this British Council is part of the organization where they pick youngsters from all over the planet, and they educate them into all the PC stuff to be the exact good robotic rulers and they'll be well rewarded for doing it, and they'll make sure the whole culture is destroyed in the process of their own countries as they go all PC and become implement what I've just talked about for the last few minutes, actually. Quite something. Also, too, getting back to genetics and all the rest of it, too, I'd like to put up tonight is to do with National Health Service in Britain. I've given talks and talks and talks about the things that have happened there. National Health Service has criticised over television advertisement, which features nurses tending to patients while a song about euthanasia plays in the background. And I tell you, even this article will be a little test to see who is going to complain. And most won't complain. They'll say, oh, well, you know. So anyway, it says it's a song about assisted dying in a major TV recruitment campaign. I don't know if it's recruitment for dying or if it's recruitment for staff. But, of course, it's for staff, supposedly. And they used something from a movie, some song from a movie, I think, in the background, and I guess it was for those who would understand what it was, and most folk wouldn't understand where it came from, what it was about, naturally. It says the Mullen Law Group produced the ad and said that the track was selected for its tone, depth and pacing rather than lyrics. I guess it did for its tone, depth and pacing, as they pace you through your life to the end, I suppose, you know. And I'll put this article up to tell you what's about, to show you what it's about and so on. But that shows, apparently it's from a movie about someone who puts a pillow over someone to smother them or something like that. I guess it's a cheap way for doing it for the National Health Service. After all, we're just peasants, you know, we're not really worth that much, are we really? And they don't have to spend more money on us than they have to when they've got all these big plans for their own future. It's quite amazing, isn't it, really? Hmm? It really is, to me, anyway. Now, I'll put up two, why the British Council was created, 1930s, that trains people across the whole planet and makes them leaders, future leaders, just like Common Purpose in Britain as well, does the same thing, and I'm sure it's related to it as well. And, of course, the British Council was given the Royal Charter in 1940, and I guess that the taxpayer and probably some private organisations fund it as well. But they pick the ones, don't forget, you think you're selecting people yourself for politics and so on, really. The leaders are all picked long, but when they're children, really, or at least youngsters, maybe early teens. They are, always. So put that up, and then the catalogue description, British Council departmental websites and websites of associated agencies and bodies. It goes on and on. I mean, literally, you spend your life reading all this stuff. This unelected organisation that runs and brings in globalism, by the way, and the multicultural stuff is to be across the whole planet, into every country. Every country is to get it. And to eventually support, I mean, even Africa that's trying to become supposedly independent by throwing all the whites out, have to accept the fact with all the money from the World Bank, etc., and the agreements they've signed on to, they've got to accept the fact that there'll be more folk moving in there eventually from all over the world, and they can't stop it. You can't be racist here and sign on to the World Bank, for goodness sake, for loans. It's designed this way. And don't forget Britain, at least London, and that run it all in Britain, the city, and runs the world and the economics and all the rest of it. The same place that brought you, that really flooded China with opium until they caved in and had to trade, forced to trade with the countries for their silk and all the rest of the stuff. This is the country that wants to help the world. Do you really think that? Do you really, really think that? Is it any surprise that Coca-Cola, that they got its name because it used to have cocaine in the cola? Isn't that when they put in cannabis in it now as well? And watch your children go happy gaga, just like Bertrand talked about, you know, keep them with pharmacology, keep them happy and content, you know. But it's all conspiracy theory, isn't it? From their own writings, it must be conspiracy theory. Who are these thousands of well-paid, well-heeled people up in these world governmental departments, writing all this stuff? I guess they're just conspiracy theorists, writing their own books, having world meetings and stuff. Anyways, the early 1930s, a time of global instability, Britain's influence was weakened because of a global financial depression, of course, which their own folk brought about, which reduced living standards, jobs, and trade. It's basically to none of the elite, you know, all these really top elitists. In fact, the banks in the city of London made fortunes through World War One, same as the US ones did too, lending to all sides. At the same time, extreme ideologies were gaining influence, etc. Fascism in Germany, Italy, Spain, and communism in Russia. And the UK government created the British Council in response to the annual report for 1940-41. The aim was to create in a country overseas a basis of friendly knowledge and understanding of the people of this country and their philosophy of way and way of life. Now they tell you what your culture must be, eh? So you can imagine what that is, eh? But of course, they create future leaders. They even have one of their articles they put up too is about creating future leaders for the world, basically. All the different agencies and bodies that they run, etc. It's just about everything, really. And how you partner with them, and every single country here, all the Arabic countries as well, have got departments in them. There's ones too about them training them, and now they've just demolished really what used to be Iraq. They're now training them into the new system, and they've got all the students grown up into more adult positions helping to run that country now too and manage it all. And UNESCO TVET program is called, as part of it too, with Iraq. I'll put up and a PDF about that. And of course UNESCO is an organization that was founded by Julian Huxley for United Nations actually. And he was a eugenicist. He talked about all this stuff and the need to cull down the populations of the planet, including the basic British people themselves, the unfit types. He just wanted the peasant class to kind of diminish eventually. But I'll put these ones up for those who want to care about it and have a look. Future Leaders Connect and Global Network for Emerging Policy Leaders. Not bad, eh? They pick them, train them, educate them, and all in the taxpayers' paycheck, eh? Or all in their purse, I should say, or in their purse. There's a lot of stuff on it, but it doesn't go into too much depth because you're not supposed to know too much, you see. And you know darn well that the ones that they're picking are very important because, they make them star quality, give them star quality. And they even make scientists stars now, of course. And there's marketing professionals. I've read their stuff before on the air years ago, who actually make top scientists into stars for television. And then the people follow up with them, what their geniuses are. But whatever they say on a social level must be true as well, so they adopt that. You know, they call it the personality. Eh? This is the age of the personality cult, really. But I'll put all that up. Also, Gordon Brown, PM of Britain at one point, who helped collapse the economy there. So he did it so well, they actually put him over to, I think it was the World Bank in the US, where he had to take over helping running that. But he's spoken out about a coming financial crash as well. Now, he works for the World Bank, at least he did. And he's in the know. And of course, he goes through the usual motions of pretending to really blast the banks for causing the last bailouts and so on and so on and so on. They do this kind of nonsense, don't they? But in reality, they're all part of the same scam. And out of that, too, he's really telling you they need an even more powerful world system to manage all the money. In other words, why don't you just give the World Bank all the power to manipulate everybody? They already manipulate everybody's currency anyway, but give them the power, legitimate power to do it, rather than just, they'll have to be really legitimate. And they all want you to agree, you see. Agree to it. Okay, I don't mind. But so they pulled him out the bag to tell us what we really need, you see, because they're constantly devaluing the currencies since the 2008 crash that they caused. You know, when we're told by those in charge of it, the money went to money heaven. That's what they literally said, that money heaven. And that'll go into the history books for us idiots. Huh? Oh, went to money heaven, eh? Mm-hmm. And then after getting bailed out, by the end of the year, they're giving themselves $1 million bonuses again, you know, twice a year or something like that. Yeah, it's a great life if you're belonging to the right groups, eh? And it's amazing, too, that how this time has just rushed in. I was just going to go through different things here. But I'll put another one, too, about, it's called The Impact of Early Medical Treatment in Transgender Youth. Now, think about what I've said before about Russell's statement about training the child to believe anything. Think about it. I'm not kidding you, folks. When society and youngsters are under massive attack by the big manipulators on this planet, and they'll want everyone to be on board with their agenda, as they literally torture people. Because if you think that they're not torturing psychologically people and children here, they certainly are. Massively so. Massively so. It's not happening by itself. It's a good article. Well, it's not in-depth that much, but it does show you the different effects on mental health, psychological well-being, physiologic parameters, and bone health. It all gets affected with all the different treatments are given them, with hormone replacements or suppression, etc., etc., etc. It's on children, right? And the rest of the public are happy and content, complacent. Like Russell said, they'd make them, you know, well entertained, a lot more happily drugged. And they would give you, now they're legalizing more drugs, legalizing drugs. They'll be cheap to buy and get them anywhere, and you'll just chill out, man, and drop out and, you know, keep cool. Why get bored about the hassles, eh? From myself, Alan Watts from Interior Canada. I'd love to go into things in more depth, but I didn't plan anything here, it just came out. It's good night, so may your God or your gods go with you.